Thank you for the kind invitation to this meeting. The leaky gut is becoming a very hot topic in medicine and in research, and this is due to a number of different factors. The first that I would like to mention is that intestinal permeability can be measured uninvasively with the oral administration of sugars, and this sugar can be recollected in the urine. And this is a very simple method that can be applied to large-scale sample of patients. So this probably gave rise to a number of different studies that investigated permeability in different human conditions. And also, the leaky gut is becoming a more scientific type of topic because we now know much better the physiology of the tight junction that regulate permeability through the epithelium in the intestine. Also, it is becoming an important topic because we know much better the microbiota today, and we understand the microbiota is very important for a number of different disorders, both gastrointestinal disorders and systemic disorders. And also, the leaky gut is important because often a leaky gut is associated with symptoms and with pathology, not only in the gastrointestinal tract, but also systemic pathology. However, there are a number of different questions that still remain unanswered. The first question is whether the leaky gut is a primary phenomenon or it is secondary to a number of different effects. What are the important components of the permeability and the other factors that influence the leaky gut? And finally, is there a cure for the leaky gut? You have seen a similar slide presented by Antonio Gasparini before. This is a list of conditions that are associated with an increased gut permeability. As we have said, these can be both GI and extra GI disorders. And for some of these conditions, the association between the leaky gut and these pathologies is very well established, and there is a clear pathogenetic role of the leaky gut. And these include, for example, IBD, or for example, in systemic condition, type 1 diabetes, HIV infection, and multi-organ failure. For other conditions, this link is less evident, and one of these is, for example, in irritable bowel syndrome or food allergy that you can see listed here. So the general hypothesis is that a leaky gut leads to the passage of a number of different antigens that are coming from the diet, are coming from the bacteria, or even the passage of entire bacterial products through the leaky gut, and then they get access to the mucosa where they stimulate abnormal responses. And these could be immunological responses and the activation of T lymphocytes, mast cells, neutrophils, that then release a number of factors that influence the permeability itself and increase and maintain this increased permeability. Also, these mediators that are released by these cells can communicate with nerves that convey information to the brain and leading thus to abdominal pain and other symptoms. So the question is the leaky gut a pathogenetic factor in certain disease? And I think that this study published some years ago by the group of Professor Sturniolo in Padua demonstrated that intestinal permeability in patients with Crohn's disease precedes the relapse of the disease, indicating that basically it can have an etiopathogenetic factor in the recrudescence and the reactivation of the inflammatory response in IBD. I would like to now talk about these two conditions in particular, IBS and IBD, and I will focus for this, for the sake of time, only on these two conditions. And these are certainly conditions that are completely separated. One is a typical example of an organic disease, IBD. And the other, IBS, is a typical example of a functional disease. You can see here that the central factors such as depression, anxiety, somatization play an important role in IBS patients and less in IBD patients, while organic factors play a role in IBD, less in IBS. However, there are evidences that suggest that at least a subgroup of patients with IBS have indeed an organic form of disease with an increased number of immune cells, for example, in the mucosa, an increased permeability, and also changes in the intestinal microbiota. So IBS can now be considered probably at least in some subgroups of the patients as a small or microorganic type of disorder. Some of the patients with IBD, when they are in remission, they develop symptoms of IBS. And this is clearly depicted here by this part of the pie. You see 35% of patients continue to have IBS symptoms in spite the resolution of the acute inflammatory process. So the question is whether these patients have an organic underlying mechanism, including inflammation or changes in permeability that can maintain the symptoms in these patients. And this has been addressed in this very nice study carried out in France by Thierry Piche, who showed that basically intestinal permeability is increased in IBS, in all the subgroups of IBS, diarrhea predominant, constipation predominant IBS, and is present in those patients with IBD in remission that continue to have symptoms, but not in those that don't have symptoms. So this clearly demonstrated that increased intestinal permeability is a pathogenetic factor involved in the pathogenesis of IBS. And there is a very nice correlation between the increased permeability and the severity of the symptoms that are experienced both by IBS patients and IBD patients with IBS symptoms. This is another interesting concept. This is the intestinal permeability in patients with Crohn's disease. In this particular study, 44% of this population had increased permeability. The interesting factor here is that the first degree relatives and without any evidence of IBD, first degree relatives of these IBD patients have an increased intestinal permeability. And this is around one quarter of these subjects. The interesting factor is that when the investigators of this particular study assessed this CARD 15 with a number of different techniques, they found that 75% of these patients had this polymorphism in this gene, suggesting that increased intestinal permeability, at least in a subgroup of patients, has a genetic background. It is also interesting to note that the prevalence of IBS is increased in first-degree relatives of patients with IBD. So this basically suggests that those patients, only relative, but not the spouses of these patients, have a genetically determined increase in permeability and probably an IBS. This is a demonstration of permeability in the gut of patients with IBS, looking basically at electron microscopy slides. You can see here the spaces between epithelial cells, and these spaces are clearly enlarged in patients with IBS with diarrhea. And also there is condensation and changes in the morphology of the tight junction. This has been nicely measured with the quantitative type of measurements, and also they found in this particular study that there was a correlation between this permeability and the severity of abdominal pain experienced by IBSD. These are studies from our laboratory in collaboration with a group in France. We basically took biopsies from the colon of patients with IBS, mounted them in using chambers to look at the permeability of a macromolecule that generally does not cross the epithelium. And you can see here that compared to healthy controls, the permeability is increased in all the subgroups of IBS. Not only the IBS-D, but also IBS-C and IBS-mixed. And this is nicely correlated to a reduction in the expression of one of the key components of the tight junction, which is zonal occludens 1. And again, as in many other studies, this is a common theme. There is an association between the increased permeability and the severity of abdominal pain. What is the consequence of this increased permeability, at least for IBS patients? Probably it's an increase in the inflammatory component in the mucosa. These are studies that we have done some years ago, looking, for example, at this particular cell, which is the mast cell. And clearly, you can see here that compared to controls, the number of mast cells are increased in the mucosa. And they are very closely related to the nerves within the intestine. And the correlation is very nice between the activated mast cells and the nerves with the severity of abdominal pain. Thus, the message here is that if permeability increases, then there is an antigenic flow to the mucosa that reacts with an increased number of immune cells that communicate to the nerves and probably lead to symptoms such as abdominal pain. This is also true for functional dyspepsia. These are experiments done by Young Tax Group, showing similar results to those that I presented to you for IBS. So this increased permeability in functional biodisorders is not restricted to IBS, but it's also present in the upper gastrointestinal tract syndromes. Stress has been always studied as a potential mechanism inducing increased intestinal permeability in animal models in particular, but now we have also data in humans. These are students from the University of Leuven that are undergoing their discussion, the discussion of their thesis. And the permeability is measured before and after the discussion of the thesis. And you can see here that the permeability increases after the discussion. And it's increased as much as it can be increased by the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, which are a well-known factor increasing permeability. Importantly, these effects can be prevented with the use of anti-inflammatory drugs, and in particular, mast cell stabilizers, which tells us that the brain communicates to the mast cells that then activate responses that lead to increased permeability. Another very important factor in this scenario of the permeability is the microbiota, and probably there are certain species of the microbiota population that are important in increasing permeability, such as Akkermansia muciniphila. You have heard a lot about this. This is a champion in degrading mucus, thus leading to the invasiveness of other bacteria, such as, for example, Fecalibacterium prausnithi, that then can lead access to the mucosa. And these are data that are indicating that in IBS and in IBD in particular, the number of microbial cells that are very close and stick to the epithelial cells is increased as compared to controls. Allergy has been always thought to be an important factor in patients with functional GI disorders and IBS in particular, and this is a very nice study that is showing that basically patients with IBS have an increased permeability again, but also those with increased permeability have also some evidence of allergy, and again a very nice correlation between the increased permeability and the severity of symptoms. Gluten sensitivity is probably another important factor. This is a study by Michael Miller's group in the United States at the Mayo Clinic. And basically, when they challenged patients with IBS with gluten, what they found was that DQ2, DQ8 positive subjects had an increased intestinal permeability along with an increased number of immune cells in the gut. What can we do at this point in order to modulate this increased permeability? There are several options. One is a dietary option. Other are pharmacological options. This is lanreotide acetate, which is a factor that acts directly on the tight junction, and it prevents the opening of the tight junction. And in this study, patients with celiac disease were challenged with gluten, and lanreotide could prevent the rapid increase in symptoms in these subjects. Another way is a natural way, using glutamine. There is evidence of reduced tissue glutamine in IBS, and the supplementation with glutamine can restore intestinal membrane permeability. Thus, gluten supplementation may be helpful in the leaky gut and particularly in patients with IBS. So I would like to wrap up and conclude. Increased intestinal permeability is very common both in GI and non-GI diseases. The leaky gut itself is not a disease, but can lead to symptoms and tissue pathology in the presence of other components, which can be a genetic predisposition, luminal factors, and other factors such as the microbiota and stress. And dietary, probiotic, and pharmacological approaches targeting intestinal permeability is like a key approach in the management of systemic and gut disorders, including IBS. Thank you very much.